Sarum students, welcome back. Today let us continue with geography lesson number 4, maps. In our previous class we had learnt about map and the different types of maps. That is, we had learnt that a map is a representation or a drawing of the earth's surface, or a part of it is drawn on a flat surface. That means we can say on a sheet of paper according to a scale. And we learnt that maps are more helpful than a globe. That is, a globe can be useful when we want to study the earth as a whole. But when we want to study only a part of the earth, maps are more useful. Why? As they represent the entire earth's surface or a part of it. And we also learnt that an atlas, it is a book or it is a collection of maps in a book. And we learnt about the different types of maps. That is, about the physical map, the political map and the thematic map. So the maps, they can be useful to show the physical features of the earth, such as mountains, plateaus, plains, etc. and political boundaries, such as countries, cities, towns and villages, as well as specific information is known to us by the thematic maps, such as road maps, rainfall maps, distribution of forests, industries, etc. Today we shall learn about the components of maps. That is, there are three components of maps: distance, direction and symbols. So let us learn about them. Components of map. Children, how many components of maps are there? There are three components of maps. First one is distance, second direction and third one is symbol. Let us start with the first one, distance. Children, you know that maps are drawings which reduce the entire world or a part of it to fit on a sheet of paper. That means we cannot show the entire earth as it is. So we have to fit it in the sheet of paper and we have to show the distance between the places as real. So how can we show that? We can show that with the help of the scale. So we can say that the maps, they are drawn to reduced scales. But to draw it to the reduced scale, it needs a great care. That is, while doing this reduction work. Why? Because they have to show the distance between the places as real. And this can be possible only when a small distance on the paper, it represents a large distance on the ground. That means the large distance of that ground or of that place is shown in the map as a small distance. So for this purpose we require a scale. So a scale, it is chosen for this purpose. Children, here you can see in the image. Okay, so what is scale? Scale is the ratio between the actual distance on the ground and the distance that is shown on the map. The scale of a map can be shown as a line with distances marked on it. That is, the scale of 1 centimeter can be used to show 100 kilometers in a map. Similarly, it can show 1 centimeter for 100 meters or 1 centimeter for 50 meters. So it depends on the map of a place that it is showing. Children, We can take one example. Suppose the distance between your school and your home is 10 kilometers. That means we can show 1 centimeter on the map, showing 5 kilometers of the ground. So the 2 centimeters will be showing the 10 kilometers. So what is the scale of your drawing then? The scale of your drawing is 1 centimeter is equal to 5 kilometers. Thus, scale is very important in any map. And if you know the scale, you will be able to calculate the distance between any two places on a map. Children, to calculate the distance between the places, we can use two types of scales. That is, small scale maps and the large scale maps. The small scale maps, they are used to show the continents and the countries. And the large scale maps, they are used to show the cities and villages. Children, you know that the continents or the countries, they are the large areas. So when the continents or the countries are to be shown on a paper, then we use a small scale. For example, we can use 1 centimeter to show the distance of 100 kilometers. That means 5 centimeters will show the distance of 500 kilometers on the map. And this is called as a small scale map. So when large areas like continents or countries are to be shown on a paper, we can use a small scale. While children, a small area like your village or a town has to be shown on a paper, then we can use a large scale map. That means we can show 1 centimeter showing the distance of 100 meters. That means 5 centimeters can be used to show 500 meters on the map. So when we have to calculate the distance between the village or the town, so we can use a large scale map. And if we take another example, if you see this image is of a map of a village, and the scale that is shown here is 1 centimeter is equal to 10 meters. So the distance of 10 meters is shown with the help of 1 centimeter of the scale. So children, it's very easy to remember. Large area, you will use small scale map. And for the small area, you will use the large scale map. So which map do you feel it provides us more information? Yes, the large scale maps, they give us more information than small scale maps. That means you can draw a small area and you can use the large scale for it. That means we can measure it in meters and accordingly we can draw the map. So the large scale maps, they are giving us more information about that small area than the small scale maps. Now let us learn the second component of map, that is direction. Children, if you have seen, most maps, they contain an arrow marked with the letter N. N stands for north, at the upper right hand corner. So this arrow, it shows the north direction and it is called the north line. What is it called? It is called as the north line. So when you know the north direction, you can easily find the other directions on the map. As you know children, there are four major directions. They are north, south, east and west. Do you know what are they called as? They are called as the cardinal points. So what are called as the cardinal points? The four major directions. Which are the four major directions? North, south, east and west. And there are four intermediate directions, that is northeast, southeast, southwest and northwest. Children, if you see the image here, you can understand between north and east, the direction that we get is the northeast. Between south and east, the direction that we get is the southeast. Between south and west, the intermediate direction that we get is the southwest. And between north and west, the direction is northwest. If we take an example, children, this is a map of India. Here, if you see the directions, north, south, east and west, and see the intermediate directions that are given, that is northwest, northeast, southwest, southeast. So by looking at the directions, you can tell the state is in which direction. So we can locate any place more accurately with the help of these intermediate directions. And if you want to go to a particular place and you don't know the exact direction where you have to proceed, then you can find out the direction of a place by using a compass. What is this compass? This compass, it is an instrument that is used to find out the main directions. Its magnetic needle is always pointing towards the north and south direction. So this compass, it will help to find out the direction in which you have to go. Now let us learn the third component of a map, that is symbols. Children, you know that it is not possible to draw on a map the actual shape and size of the different features such as buildings, roads, bridges, trees, railway lines or a well. Can you draw all these things on a map? No, isn't it? So they are shown by using certain letters or shades, colors, pictures and lines. So these are the symbols that give a lot of information in a limited space, that is on a map. So a lot of information is given with the help of the symbols. So the maps can be drawn easily and they are simple to read. Even if you don't know the language of an area and therefore you cannot ask someone for the directions, but you can collect information from the maps with the help of these symbols. This means that maps have a universal language that can be understood by all, and there is an international agreement regarding the use of these symbols. So these are called as conventional symbols. That means certain letters, shades, colors, pictures, lines, these all symbols, they are universally accepted. And there is an international agreement regarding the use of these symbols, and so they are called as conventional symbols. Here are some of the conventional symbols that are shown in this figure. You can see the railway line. You can see the broad gauge, the meter gauge and railway station. See the symbols that are used for these. Then you can see the roads, that is the symbol for the metal road and the unmetal road. Similarly, you can see the boundaries. You can see the international boundary. See the symbol for it. Then the state boundary and the district boundary. Then you can also see the symbols that are used for river, well, tank, canal and bridge. and see the symbols used for temple, church, mosque, chhatri. And the letters PO is used for post office, and PTO is used for post and telegraph office, and PS is used for police station. Then you can see the symbols that are used for settlement and graveyard. You can also see the symbols for trees and grass. Children, you cannot show the actual features of such huge things. So symbols can help us to locate what is there in that particular area. Various colors are also used for the same purpose. For example, generally blue is used for showing water bodies, and brown is used for showing mountains. We can show plateaus by using yellow color, and green is used for showing plains on the map. So certain standard colors are used in maps to show features such as oceans, seas, rivers, mountains, plateaus, plains, etc. Now children, let us do a quick recap of the topics that we have learned today. Today we learned about the three components of maps. That is, we learned about distance, direction and symbol. First, we learned about distance. That is, maps are drawings which reduce the entire world or a part of it to fit on a sheet of paper. And these maps, they are drawn to reduced scales. And this has to be done very carefully so that the distance between the places is real. And this can be possible only when a small distance on paper represents a large distance on the ground. And for this, a scale is used. So, what is a scale? We learned that scale is the ratio between the actual distance on the ground and the distance shown on the map. And we use two types of scales: small scale map and large scale map. So when large areas like continents or countries are to be shown on a paper, then we use a small scale. So it is called as a small scale map. And when we have to show a small area like your village or a town, then we use a large scale. That is, 5 centimeters we will show it as 500 meters on the ground. So it is called as a large scale map, and this shows that large scale maps, they give us more information. That is, it tells us more in detail about the particular place than the small scale maps. Then we learnt about direction. Most of the maps we usually see the letter N at the upper right hand corner, and this arrow, it shows us the north direction. So it is called as the north line. And once when we know the north direction, it is easy to find the other directions. That is, we can easily find east, west and south. And there are four major directions: north, south, east and west, and they are called cardinal points. And other four intermediate directions are northeast, southeast, southwest and northwest. And we can easily locate any place more accurately with the help of these intermediate directions. And we can also find out the direction of a place with the help of a compass. Its magnetic needle always points towards the north-south direction, so it helps to find the direction of the place easily. Do you know, children, compass has been used by travelers and sailors since ages. Then we learnt about symbols. That is, it is the third important component of a map, and it is not possible to draw on a map the actual shape and size of the different features such as buildings, roads, bridges, etc. So the letters or shades, colors, pictures, these symbols are drawn and they give a lot of information in a limited space. And these maps, they have a universal language that can be understood by all. And there is an international agreement regarding the use of these symbols. And these symbols, they are called as the conventional symbols. Here, some conventional symbols are shown. And we also use various colors for the same purpose. For example, generally, blue is used for showing water bodies, brown for mountain, yellow for plateau, and green is used for plains. Children, I hope you have understood the components of map that we have learned today very well. We will learn more about this lesson, that is about a sketch and a plan, in our next class. Till then, goodbye and take care.